الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
Today I want to speak about a superpower which existed in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Basically, there were two superpowers which existed in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: the Romans and the Persians. But the greater out of these two superpowers was the Persian Empire. It was a grand empire which ruled for more than 1200 years. And it was an empire of opulence and grandeur. And you can ascertain this from the fact that every morning, the Persian Kisra, the Persian emperor, before he would have an audience with anybody, they would lower a crown upon his head, which was made out of pure gold, and it weighed 14 stones, 200 pounds, and it would be suspended from the ceiling with gold chains, and it was laden with rubies and emeralds. And then they would put the rest, they would embellish him with the rest of his jewelry. And then only would the curtain be open, and whoever would see the Kisra, the emperor, he would be overawed by the magnificence and the opulence. And at that very same time, there was another king, the king of all kings, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who resided in Medina. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, upon occasion, he went into the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was lying on a date leaf mat. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat up, and the imprints of the date palms were left in the back of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Umar radiallahu anhu mentions that I looked around the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all I found were three tan skins and a handful of barley, and my eyes began to flow. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw me crying, and he said, "Oh Umar, what is making you cry?" And I said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, look at the opulence in which the Kisra, the Roman Emperor, and the Persian Emperor live in. And you are the Messenger of Allah, and look at the simplicity in which you live." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaning on a pillow, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat up. And he said, Umar, even you, have you not even understood that the ease of the hereafter and the comfort of the hereafter is better than the ease of this dunya?" And then the Prophet ﷺ said, "What do I want with the dunya? For I am like a person who is traveling and rests under a tree." And then he moves on. And then he moves on. And this was the king of all kings. And what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say about the superpower of his time? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was migrating from Makkah to Medina, the mushrikeen put a bounty on the head of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of 100 camels. And the man spotted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he went back to his people and he said, "I've seen Muhammad and his companion." And in that gathering there was a man called Suraqa ibn Malik. And Suraqa wanted to attain the bounty himself. And he said, "No, it's not him, it's somebody else." And Suraqa discreetly, he left the gathering. He went home, he took his sword, he mounted his horse, and he went in the pursuit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Suraqa himself mentions that I was coming closer and closer, and there were two men. One man wouldn't look back at all, and the other man kept on looking back. And Suraqa came closer and closer, until the man who kept on looking back, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, began to cry. And the Messenger of Allah said, "Abu Bakr, what's making you cry?" And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, true to form, he said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, it is not my safety that I'm concerned about, it is your safety." And then Suraqa mentioned that I came so close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I could hear the recitation of his Quran. And then the Prophet ﷺ supplicated, and the forelegs of the horse of Suraqa, it sank into the sand, and Suraqa fell off his horse. And before that day, Suraqa had never fallen off his horse. And Suraqa, he mounted his horse again, and he went in the pursuit of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ supplicated again, and Suraqa fell off again, and Suraqa ascended his horse for the third time, and he went in the pursuit of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ supplicated again, and Suraqa fell off his horse. And Suraqa, then he understood that this man was something else. And Suraqah mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ did not even look back once. And Suraqah said, "Oh Muhammad, wait! Oh Muhammad, wait!" And the Prophet ﷺ turned around and Suraqah said, "Oh Muhammad, give me protection. For if ever the Muslims take a place, I will have your protection." And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Suraqah, on one condition. On one condition, that you cover our tracks." And Suraqah said, "I will cover your tracks." And the Prophet ﷺ dictated a letter to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and they gave it to Suraqah ibn Malik. And Suraqah was turning away, and the Prophet ﷺ said, "Oh Suraqah, how will it be that a day will come and you will wear the bangles of the Emperor of Persia? Suraqah, how will it be a day will come and you will be wearing the bangles of the leader of the superpower of the day?" And Suraqah left and he met a group of people in pursuit of the Prophet ﷺ, and they asked him, "Have you seen Muhammad and his companion?" And Suraqah said, "I've been up this path and I've seen nobody." And Suraqah mentioned, "In the morning I left with the intention of killing the Prophet ﷺ, and by evening I returned protecting him." And it was in the time of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu that the Persians amassed a huge army. And Umar radiallahu anhu knew that this was a defining battle. Over 100,000 Persians gathered. And Umar radiallahu anhu wanted to be in charge of this army himself. And Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu, he objected. He said, "Amir al-Mu'mineen, if you die, then we jeopardize our conquest and our expansion. Somebody else in your place. Send somebody else in your place. Who could replace Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu?" And they all sat and they began to think. And then Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu said, "Wajadtuhu." He said, "I found him. Al-Asadu fi barathinihi." He said, "The lion in his den." Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu. For Sa'd was the first man in the history of Islam to shed the blood of the enemy of Allah. He was the first man in the history of Islam to shoot an arrow. He was the man who was guaranteed Jannah by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sa'd radiallahu anhu left with 32,000 Muslims to face the superpower of the day. And they camped in a place called Qadisiyah. And Rustam, who was the second in charge of the Persians, the Dick Cheney of his day, he sent a message to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, and he said, "Send me a man that I can speak to." And Sa'd radiallahu anhu sent a man that if this incident had not happened, it is a strong possibility that we would have never heard his name. He was a Sahabi called Rabi ibn Amir radiallahu anhu. Rabi radiallahu anhu was a Sahabi who had spent his entire life in bondage. He had been a slave all his life. He was an Abyssinian slave. And Rabi radiallahu anhu left the camp of the Muslims on his small mule. And when he reached the camp of the Persians, they said, "Descend from your mule." And Rabi radiallahu anhu said, "You requested me to come. Now you will accept my conditions. I will not descend." And the narrations mention that the tent of the Persian was embellished like never before. It had silk lining all the way through, and they had pillows which had silk and gold lining upon it. Why? Because they thought that when this Bedouin, he would see the opulence and the grandeur, he would capitulate, he would be overawed. But not for a moment was Rabi affected by this glamour and this opulence. Why? Because Rabi radiallahu anhu understood that the treasure that he had was the treasure of Iman. And this was an eternal treasure. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam wa kafa biha ni'ma." All praise be to Allah upon the ni'ma of Islam. And if this was the only ni'ma that man was given, it would suffice. And he understood that the treasure that they had was the treasure of the dunya. And the dunya was transient. It was short-lived. And not for a moment was he affected, influenced by the glamour and the glitter which was around him. And the narrations mention that Rabi was riding a small mule. He had tatty clothes on which had patches upon him. And he had a sword. And the sheath of the sword was made out of cloth. And when he entered the court of Rustam, who was sitting on a huge bed and he had a crown upon his head, Rustam's cronies, when they saw Rabi radiallahu anhu, they began to laugh. They began to laugh. Why? Because they judged him by his apparent. But little did they know that underneath those tatty clothes and that dark skin lay characteristics for which Allah defined him as radiallahu anhum wa radu an, that Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. And the narrations mention that Rabi radiallahu anhu, he reached the bed of Rustam, he got off his mount, and he struck one of the pillows with his sword. And he made a hole in the pillow, and he tied his mule. And then they had placed a huge pillow for him to sit on. And he struck that with his spear, and he removed it, and he sat on the floor. And Rustam said, "Why did you do that for? What made you do that?" And he said, "I do not wish to sit on the dunya that you present me. I prefer to sit on the floor." And then Rustam asked him, he said, "Ma alladhi ja'a bikum?" He said, "What's brought you people?" Because even Rustam knew that these weren't your normal conquerors. There was something different about these people. And he said, "Ma alladhi ja'a bikum?" He said, "What brought you?" And listen to the words of Rabi radiallahu anhu, because they are a lesson for me and you. He didn't say that Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas sent us. He didn't say that Umar ibn Khattab sent us. He didn't even say that this was a mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he said, "Wallahu ta'athana." He said, "Allah sent us." He said, "Our duty is from Allah." "Wallahu ta'athana linukhrija man sha'a min ibadihi min ibadati al-ibad ila ibadati rabbil ibad wa jawri al-adyan ila adl al-islam wa dhiki al-dunya ila sa'ati al-akhirah." He said, "Allah has sent us to remove whoever he wishes from the servitude of man to the servitude of the Lord of man, and from the unjust nature of other religions and systems to the justice of Islam, and from the tight confinement of this dunya to the vast expansion of the hereafter." This is why Allah has sent us. Allah has sent us to remove whoever he wishes from the servitude of man to the servitude of the Lord of man. And nobody understood this better than Rabi, for he was a man who had spent his entire life in bondage, entire life in slavery, entire life in serving other people. And when he embraced Islam, he was emancipated and he became the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Rabi radiallahu anhu said to Rustam, he said, "If you accept what we have brought, then we will go back. But if you refuse, then we will fight you until we reach the promise of Allah. If you accept, then we will go back." And it shows that these people weren't interested in conquering other people. All they were concerned was spreading justice. That's all they were concerned. And this is why they're saying, "If you accept, then we will go back. But if you refuse, then we will fight you." Why? Because the Persians were known for their tyranny. When the Persians took over Yemen and the Abyssinian Christians ruled Yemen, the narrations mention that the Abyssinians rebelled. And what the Persians did is that any person who had a drop, of Abyssinian blood in him, they killed him. The narrations mention that they would slit the stomach of the women and they would rip their children out. This is how barbaric they were. And this is the nature of most superpowers, that they regard the blood of other people as very light. They regard their blood as important and the blood of other people are very light. And then Rustam said to Rabi radiallahu anhu, he said, "You say, if I refuse, you will fight me until you reach the promise of Allah. Tell me, what is this promise of Allah?" Subhanallah, Rabi said, "The promise of Allah is Jannah for those who die fighting and victory for those who remain behind." And then Rustam asked him, he said, "Tell me, are you their leader?" And Rabi radiallahu anhu said, "No, I'm not their leader. I am the lowest from amongst them, but the believers are like one body." The believers are like one body. The high assists the low, and the low assists the high. And he was expounding upon the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-mu'minuna kajasadin wahid," that the believers are like one body. If the head hurts, the entire body feels a source of discomfort. And if the eyes hurt, the entire body feels uneasy.